Hey everyone, I've been meaning to make a video on Sirilic for a couple of months since the processing of the green comet back in January. I haven't had a lot of time, but I finally have some time to introduce Sirilic to you. If you've used Siril, you know that the preprocessing steps where you add all of your files, you go through the preprocessing steps and stacking them individually, subtracting, blah blah blah, can take some time. So Sirilic is actually a separate software that was written that makes it a lot easier. So it automates a whole lot of the preprocessing steps. So you just add everything into Sirilic, into the UI. You tell it to run the scripts and it does a lot of things for you. But one of the advantages of using Sirilic is that it actually lets you do multi-session stacking, which Siril doesn't let you do. So when I do multi-session stacking, I either use Sirilic or I actually use my default processing software, the AstroPixelProcessor, which makes it a lot easier to do natively. So to get Sirilic, you can go to siril.org/docs/Sirilic to get some documentation on it. It tells you all the things that it does and doesn't do. So for example, if I go down, say it doesn't do channel composition, color calibration, background extraction, so you'd have to do that later on. And again, like I said, you can do background extraction on the individual raw images, which is a big bummer, but this makes the preprocessing steps so much easier that it doesn't really matter. Going back to the table of contents, you click on downloads, it has a link to their GitLab releases page. So you can click on that. Once you open the Sirilic, so I'm going to go over just the Windows application since that's what I'm using. So you'll download the latest version here, the Windows package. Once you download that, it will become in a zip file. So you will extract it. And it'll ask you for a password, which is just Sirilic, S-I-R-I-L-I-C, and it extracts, and you get another folder here. So this is what you'll run. So it doesn't install anything. So you just click, if you just click on this and run it, so let's do that. It'll say Windows protected your PC because it's unrecognized. So you may have to do more and then click run anyway. So there you go, it runs. So it does kind of remember your previous session, which I'll be redoing anyways, the M45, which will be processing today. I'm going to close this and I'm going to reopen this in a second, but I want to show you that Sirilic does symbolic linking. To get that to work on your computer, on your Windows 10, you do open start. And once you start typing in the word developer, one of the options you'll see is a developer settings. So you click on that. You want to make sure that this is turned on, so install apps from any known source, including loose files. So this will turn on developer mode. Day two of recording for me, and I have Sirilic back up here into a fresh slate. So before we start importing our images, I want to show you some of the settings here. So if you go to File, Preferences, you want to make sure that the working directory is set. So I have it set to my pictures directory in a subdirectory called Sirilic. If you want to put it somewhere else, make sure you know you have no space for these projects, and you can do that as well. By default, it'll have the Siril executable file in the program files, Siril bin, Siril.exe location. If for some reason you have it installed somewhere else, you can click on the ellipses button and point it there. Or you can click on default and it'll refill this again. The only thing you want to make sure that you have changed if this is unchecked is the use symbolic links here. So couple minutes ago, we set up developer mode in our computer so that we can use symlinks, which will help save a ton of time and a ton of resources in terms of hard drive space. So you can just press OK when you're done. Next thing we're going to look at is if we go to Project, click Edit Properties. So this option we have, so by default, it'll select multi-session, CFA, and identical parameters for all. You can leave this as is. You can also select intermediate stacking for multi-session. We don't need it. I will do a video on multi-session processing later on, so come back and we'll do that. For now, the multi-session option is pretty useless for now, but equalize CFA is great because it does, again, if you hover over it, it gives you a little tooltip which says option equalizes the mean intensity of RGB layers of the CFA flat master. So that helps a lot. All right, so now we're going to create a new project. So click on File, New. Just to quickly go over this interface, this is pretty self-explanatory. For example, the object name should be the object that you're using. For me, it'll be M45. The session name can be anything. It starts with S for session. You can put in a whole word, you can put in numbers, etc. Number of sessions is just a number of sessions that you're working with. I am doing just one. The layers are where the important stuff is, because this tells Siril which algorithms to use and how to stack. So for example, you have the mono, the light or the luminance layer is selected by default. You have your R, G, and B layers here, along with narrowband for H alpha, H beta, S2, and O3. What I'll be using today is the OSC CCD option under color. I used to use DSLR when I used to use a DSLR for deep space. You can also use just a single H alpha filter, or if you have like an L extreme or an L enhanced filter, you can use the duo HA03. And then I'm not going to go over the green and the debayerized, which is just if you debayerized your frames earlier, you can tell Siril to save some time and not debayer them again. So this is all we have to do. So you'll see that it created a working directory for me. So it has these, sort of like this is the default working directory, and it created three new subdirectories, M45, RGB, and the S, which is the session. So once you start putting files in here and we create our directories and copy link, we'll see those get filled in. So before we do that, we're going to go into the files tab up here. So this interface could be a little bit familiar to you. In Siril, we have just one long one where you have to add stuff, remove them, create a sequence, etc. Here we have a different Dropbox for each of our settings, each of our different types of images. So the image here is going to be our lights. So I'm going to grab my M45 image from here. This is from October. Move it in here. And then I'll skip through adding the rest of them so that I don't bore you. Okay, so I went and got all of the other calibration frames and I added them in here. I don't have any dark flats. I usually don't take them. So next we're going to go into properties. So these are the default options. So these are the different like stacking and preprocessing tabs that you see in Siril. You can leave this as blank, or you can change like the rejection type from like winsorized to generalized or linear fit. If you've seen my comet stacking video, you know that I like linear fit for comet stacking. You can also do MAD, blah, blah, blah. So you can leave these all as blank if you want. The only thing we're going to change here is the bias subtract here, because we want to subtract the bias from the flats. Otherwise, it doesn't do it. So I don't know why this isn't selected by default when they do have you add the bias frames here. So, but it's it's not really a complaint. It's just pointing out that you should do that. You can also subtract biases from your darks and your dark flats as well, which we don't need to do. If you want to change the default options for any of these other settings, such as the flat setting, you can click on the little ellipses button to show the other options, and you can select and change up the rejection type, the high and low sigmas, and the normalization, but it does actually select the proper values for you here, which is great. Next, we'll go to process tab. And in the process tab, you'll see exactly all the steps that Sirilic is going to take using Siril as the back end for all of these. And you can see the arrows, which way they're going. The first time I used Sirilic, I found this super helpful because it actually helped me understand what the background processes of like every stacking software that we use. The stacking process is probably the same in Deep Sky Stacker as well. I know it is for AstroPixelProcessor. So if you start off with the offset slash bias, you do a sigma stack here, create a bias master, and then it goes and gets subtracted from the flats. So once all of the masters are done, after you have your flat master and your dark master, so the darks get subtracted from your lights, and then it gets divided by the flat. And then it gets registered and stacked, again, all using Siril as the back end, since Sirilic is just an outside application, and then you get a result here. So once you're here, what you want to do is click Actions, and we're going to click on step one to build directories and copy links and images, or copy link the images. If you need to stop this, you can go to Actions and click on Abort Action, and it'll stop it. And the one thing I'll point out here is that it's showing you that it's doing a link. So this is what's creating the sim links. And if I go back to my directory here, it created an M45 directory, RGB, S. If I go to my images, source, you'll see that these are sim links. So if I hover over this, it says it's type sim link and it's a size 0 bytes. So it's actually referencing, it's just a pointer to where the actual images are located. And it saves a ton of time. Okay, going back to Sirilic, so copy finished. And then next we're going to do is we're going to click on actions. and step two to run the actual scripts. And this is going to be super fast, relatively speaking. It'll take a couple of minutes. The first time I ran this, it took so long that it actually turned me off of Siril, but it's been so much better. And it's all thanks to the Siril team, who have made, you know, the actual Siril software much easier to use. I don't know if it's easier to use, but they did make a lot of processing and performance improvements over the last couple of years. All right, that took just a few minutes, and this is done. So it actually did open up Siril as a set here. Now it says Siril waiting a few seconds. And it did open up Siril in my other window. So this is what it looks like here. So this is the unstretched version. I'll also point out that if you go into the source directory here, if you go to M45, it also creates a TIFF file, an unstretched TIFF file, so that you can process it in Photoshop or GIMP or whatever your favorite post-processing software is. So this is just the unstretched version. And maybe I'll process in Photoshop one day and show you. So going back to Siril, so if you want to see what it looks like, you can click on auto stretch, and this is what it looks like. As I mentioned before, that you can't do a background extraction on each of the raw image files, which is a little bit of a bummer, but it's definitely not a deal breaker, because it can, this saves you a ton of time. And we can still do a background extraction in Siril here. So go to image processing, click on background extraction, do polynomial, degree order 1, I'll generate, and it'll generate all these markers here. And you can right click on them and remove a bunch of them that you think will be around the nebulosity. So that's what I will do. Also, one of the improvements I like about Siril is that you can now do that in RGB. In the past, you'd have to go to one of the mono RG, R or G or B tabs here to do it. And I love that there's no red here, because it's all just reflection nebula. So you go to RGB, click on compute background, and it got rid of the blue hue. So there you have it. So this is good. So I'll click on apply, and there you go. So this is pretty good. Like, this is something, like, if this was a few years ago, I'd be more than happy to just share this, be done with it. But we can do some more image processing. So here I'll go to remove the green noise. It's a little bit harder to see, so I'll zoom in. So I'll do average neutral, click apply. And you can see that it did change a little bit. So I think it does look a little bit better. So I'll, didn't mean to click apply, I'll close it. Image processing, we can do a color calibration. So we can do a photometric color calibration here. This is also pretty cool. So once you're here, there are a couple of ways of doing the color calibration. First is in the image parameters, you can search for like M45, click find. So you can click on this and it'll fill in the coordinates so that Siril knows how to exactly color calibrate it. The other way you can do it is something that I am lucky with, is because my capture equipment will actually put the metadata of the right ascension and declination into the image. So like, for example, if I get rid of this, if I click on get metadata from image, it actually does find it. Oops. There you go. I'll do 1 instead of the get metadata, and you can see that it just refills it because it's within the metadata of the image. So it's very accurate for me because it's already plate solved. The other thing you can do is on the bottom right here, you have this WCS, which is the world coordinate system, plate solving that's built into Siril. So you can click on this and it'll actually plate solve for you and shows you exactly what's here. And you can see that M45 is this big nebula here. So you can select this and you can put that in there, find, and then plate solve, and then you're good to go. But I'm gonna turn that off. I already have my information, so I'll click on OK. And it did do a little bit of color calibration, so the orange star here got a little bit brighter, the background got a little bit darker, and the nebulosity, I think, pops a little bit more, like around here. So I'm done with that. The penultimate thing I'm going to do here before I am done with this is to do is noise reduction. So open the denoise window. I zoomed in so you can see what it looks like now. I'll just keep everything as default and then click apply. There you go. It has been denoised. A little blurry. Maybe I could have done it a little bit less, but this is what M45 looks like with a noise reduction. So you can always undo and redo to see the differences. You can see that the noise reduction does make the nebulosity a little bit brighter. And before I do that, the one thing I did forget to show you is that you can actually select this, right click and crop it so that it looks a little bit better. sometimes it's good to crop it first and then do the processing steps. It helps Siril if you don't have the stacking artifacts on the sides. But anyways, it wasn't that important for this bright nebula here. So once I'm here, I'll click on the auto stretch button here, click on go back to linear, so it's still linear, so none of the stretches actually show up for us. It does for the computer though. And then we can do a histogram stretch. In the latest version of Cyrillic, it comes with a generalized hyperbolic stretch transformation. So if you click on this, you can play with the stretch factors and the local stretch intensity and come up with something similar to what we had. Yeah, so you can play with this. You can see that I'm not very good at it. I have not gotten enough practice out of it, so I do need to play more with this. So that's why I'm not gonna use this. So I'll just close this, and then I'll do just a regular histogram transformation, which is what I'm used to. And the easiest way to do this is to just click on this little button here, which says auto stretch. So it'll apply the auto stretch. This is what it looks like. And then you can zoom in and play around with the settings. So, but I'm just gonna keep it on auto stretch because it does look pretty good. And click apply. And you can close this. And now if we go into this little button here, not that, this one, save the current image in a different name. So again, it has the RGB fit that we just edited, and it has the RGB TIFF that's out of Cyrillic, so we can edit that in Photoshop if we want. But I'm just going to change this to a TIFF file, and then I will just name it as M45 TIFF. Do 16-bit unsigned integer, and if I go into my directory here, now we have an m45.tiff file, and it looks pretty good, right? It looks pretty good to share. I will, again, like I said, I'll edit this in Photoshop a little bit more to make the blue of the nebulosity pop a little bit more before I share it. If you have any questions about Sirilic or Siril, let me know in the comments below. If you want some of these files to play with, let me know as well. I don't have any plans on uploading this anywhere yet, but if there's enough interest, I'll put it somewhere, like I did with the comment video a couple months ago. So until next time, clear skies.